that is money, status, and power. These are perceived to be the three strong pillars of career planning. I have been a career counselor for the last 25 years, and during these years, I have seen students choose careers against many a times their natural abilities. And sometimes they have chosen their careers mainly because, as we all know, salary, or the package as we call it, is supreme. And everything has to be sacrificed in the name of the scope of a career. So while I've been talking to students, and as you can imagine, 25 years is a long time, I have also kept in touch with many of my students. And over the years, some of them have also been telling me a lot about how their own career journey has gone. So after I have guided them in college or in school, they have also been sharing insights about what their own journey has been like. Some of them, unfortunately, have also come back to me to talk about the failures they've had in their career. And the failures have always been, or very often been, about emotional resilience. So one of the students that I worked with, excellent credentials, great academics, came back after 5 years and was telling me how he is being consistently sidelined in his company because of his inability to manage his anger. He was short-tempered, shouted at his colleagues, and was completely unpopular, as you can well imagine. Another student of mine, similarly, came back from the US after he was fired from his job. A year later, he was still at home, unable to apply for another job, unable to overcome the absolute anger and the grief that he felt for having been fired inappropriately, or so he thought. In order to help students like these who were coming to me and talking about their career failures, I started to read a lot more about emotional resilience, emotional development, and how it is important that we manage our emotions and how that eventually also aids in our career success. I became so passionate about each of these topics that I eventually decided to switch careers and move from being a career counselor, and I joined IIT Bombay as a positive mental health counselor, such that I could understand the students, their career paths, but not just from their strengths and skills point of view, which is what traditional career counseling thinks about, but from the perspective of the entire mosaic that life is for each one of us. Because life for each one of us is not just our cognitive skills, is not just our soft skills or analytical skills, but it is also a huge pool of emotions, that whirlpool within us. So how we manage crisis? Can we overcome failure? Can we manage our anger? Do we have the appropriate coping strategies to manage life such that when problems come, when storms come in our life, just like a rubber band, which is a classic example of resilience, if you pull a rubber band across, you will find that it stretches and then comes back to its own place. That's resilience. And emotional resilience is that when we are stretched against our natural way of being, Can we then come back to our calm state and balanced state of mind? Since we all think that emotions are for the weak, I've had students who tell me, "Ma'am, emotions are for weak people. What are you talking about all this to us? We are strong. We can bury emotions and get on with our lives, and we can just completely focus on going through the ladder of success on the basis of career planning." Unfortunately, that's true for a lot of people, that they think that emotions are not really important for them. And that brings me to the point as to how there is a huge gap between what we show to the external world, and to the external world we show MSP, how we have conquered money, status, and power. But in our internal world, it is totally a different thing. We have anger, we have jealousies, we have anxieties, we have fears, and each of these prevents us from showing to the rest of the world what is actually happening inside of us. So when we meet a friend and we say, "Hey, how are you doing?" "I'm fine." And they ask you back, "So how are you doing?" "Great." We are always great. We have a positive highlight reel which we are constantly showing to the world. So what that means in real terms is that very rarely do we make genuine connections. So in the previous slide, we saw how everything was going well with our student, but in the internal world, we saw that he has anger, heartbreak, fear, and complete stress. So as you can see, in the previous slide we saw that everything is great in the external world, but in the internal world of our superhero, there is a lot that is not going on very well. Now, failure is a funny thing, and we all have experienced it at some point or the other. I think there's hardly a person in this room who would never have experienced the bitter taste of failure. And that brings me to a very important point, which is why it is important that we have emotional resilience. And as you can see in this, the rock is split into two. But if you notice, there is fresh growth inside the rock, and that reiterates my point that no matter what failure we experience, no matter what cracks we experience, we will always, always have room for fresh growth. And not only just failure, but change has been struck on all of us when the pandemic hit us. And each of us might have realized that how, when the pandemic hit, many of our friends dealt with their emotions differently. There were some who completely adapted to the pandemic and all the requirements of the lockdown. They were graceful about it. "I cannot control the situation. I'll not be able to go out. I'll not be able to do 10 other things. But maybe I can do another 5 things here And that shows that they have emotional resilience. However, some of you in your family or in your friend circle might have seen some students or some people at least who were angry, frustrated at what the lockdown had done to their lives, and they were unable to move away from that sense. Now, the question that we need to ask is that can resilience be taught? Can we learn and teach resilience to young students in our schools and colleges? If I wanted to lift 20 kilos of weight, at my physical fitness levels, I'll probably not even be able to do that. But if I wanted to do that, then the first thing most of you will tell me is that hit the gym, do the weight training, do the flexibility training, and do it every day. And on the first day, don't try and lift 20 kilos. Maybe start with 5. So it is a gradual process. Muscular building is a gradual process. Emotional resilience is no different. Building emotional resilience is also a gradual process. And can schools and colleges, what can they do to build the EQ of their students? So some of the things that schools and colleges can consider doing is that they can talk to students in terms of organize short courses, enrichment classes, and even encourage students to participate in empathy building exercises where they go and volunteer with NGOs and help others. We think that when it is about our emotional building, we must do things for ourselves, but that's not true. If you want to build something for yourself in emotional world, sometimes it helps to build compassion. It helps to build empathy. It helps to build listening skills. Now, the onus in this, I think, is not just on the schools and colleges. I think a strong onus of this is on all of us, each one of us. We know best how our own strengths and weaknesses are, and we can curate experiences for ourselves which will help us to eventually build gradually the right amount of, such that we are able to take more balanced opinions where there is calm and there is evenness in our minds. And very famously, the yin and the yang symbol reminds us that just as there is success, there is failure. Just as there is light, there is darkness. We cannot escape either of the two. Positive and the negative are two parts of one whole. And that is a change of perspective that we can build in our own lives to fully understand how we can eventually move on and accept both sides of the coin. Now, I have always been fascinated by butterflies. That's my favorite photograph that I have taken. Their life is all about transformation. They are born as caterpillars. They go into a cocoon. They think inside, what do I want my life to be? How do I want to change my life? And while they are resting in the cocoon, they emerge. And what do you know? While the caterpillar could not fly, the butterfly can. And it's such a powerful metaphor of transformation that each one of us can do in our lives. The pandemic, in many ways, has been like a cocoon that all of us were forced into. Not by choice, I agree, but we were all forced into it. We all went into that cocoon, in that lockdown. And many of us introspected. Many of us thought about how can I change my life when so much is changing around me. And through this pandemic, I think through this cocoon that all of us have gone into, I invite you to come out of this cocoon, raise your wings, join me and raise your wings out of this cocoon, such that each one of us can be transformed. But let the transformation not just be about us, but let the transformation be for the benefit of all those who are around us. Thank you. Thank you.